Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2024. We have apologies today from Monica Lennon, and so I welcome Sarah Boyett to the meeting. The first item on the agenda is a decision on taking business in private. This is a decision on taking items 5, 6, 7 and 8 in private. Item 5 is the consideration of the evidence we will hear today on the Land Reform Bill. Item 6 is consideration of correspondence about the appointment to the Scottish Land Commission. Item 7 is consideration of correspondence about an appointment to the Environmental Standards Scotland. And item 8 is consideration of the committee's work programme. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Good. So we'll turn to agenda item 2. Which is our fourth evidence session on the Land Reform Scotland Bill. And our focus today is on part two on the bill and leasing lands. I'm very pleased to welcome Gemma Cooper from the Head of Policy of the National Farmers Union Scotland, Christopher Nicholson, the Chairman of the Scottish Tenant Farmers Association, Jackie McCreary, the Legal Advisor for Scottish Land and Estates, Mari Robertson, the Land Manager and Chartered Surveyor with the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors, and Jeremy Moody, the Secretary and Advisor for the Central Association of Agricultural Valuers. Good morning to you all. There are a heap of questions which are going to come your way this morning. So I thought I'd just open up with a very simple yes or no question. But before I do that, thank you for reminding me. I have to make a declaration of my interests. That is that, and I do this every time, that I have an interest in a farming partnership in Moray, as set out in my register of interest. Specifically, I declare an interest as an owner of approximately 500 acres of farmland, of which approximately 50 acres is woodland. I also declare that I'm a tenant of approximately 500 acres in Moray under a non-agricultural tenancy, and I have another farming tenancy for about 20 acres under the Agricultural Holdings Scotland Act 1991. I should also declare that occasionally, if I can, I take on grass lets on an annual basis. Now, we've allowed 90 minutes for this, but we'll see how we go. So I'm going to go to my easy question. It was a very interesting session we had at the Highland Show on Friday, I think it was. But my question is a yes-no answer. Is part two of the bill going to create more agricultural tenants in Scotland? You can give a yes-no or a simple sentence with it. Start with you, Gemma.
No, we don't believe it will.
Christopher.
It won't, for reasons that are not in the bill, but it will help preserve the tenanted sector that we have at present.
Okay, Jackie.
I would agree with Christopher. It will strengthen the cocoon for the existing 91 Act tenancies, but it won't facilitate new tenancies.
Jeremy.
No, it won't.
The only hope in the bill is if something more positive and stronger were done with the land use tenancy to create a new start for lettings. Otherwise, it's just part of the palliative care for a decaying sector.
Okay.
I would agree with Jeremy. No, we don't think that it will.
Oh. Well, I was hoping for a positive start to the meeting. It sounds like we've got a negative start. Right, I'm going to move to Douglas Lumsden for the first question.
Convener, I think that negativity might actually continue because I'm going to talk about the model lease for environmental purposes. And I think from all your submissions that you've stated that you feel that the status of the model lease is unclear where part of the activity will be agricultural. So can you maybe expand on that? I'll start with Gemma, if you wish.
Yeah, absolutely. So this is a new form of tenancy that the Scottish Government is looking to bring forward. It's to allow for sustainable and regenerative farming to take place. But it's become clear in discussions that the status of that lease is unclear. It's designed for situations, according to the Scottish Government, where less than half of the activity on that holding is agricultural practice. The issue with there being any agricultural practice is that then potentially that creates an agricultural lease. And I think the committee took evidence last week where the lawyers probably went into more detail on this. But essentially the lease as written is probably going to have a bit of an identity crisis. I think the legislation, the bill puts a duty on the Scottish Government to prepare some sort of model lease that the sector would then follow. We haven't had any positive feedback on this as a proposal. We think it will lead to confusion. We're not convinced it will create opportunity. Our tenants in particular are really worried that this actually might be a competitor to traditional agricultural leases. So as it stands at the moment, we think that it's something that potentially won't be used, it's something that's not needed. The potential is there already to create commercial leases, which don't have to be complicated and they don't have to be expensive to prepare. So as drafted, we think that this is just superfluous. We don't think it's going to meet the objective that Scottish Government is looking for it. And we think that it's possible, as we said at the moment, within a commercial lease to do this. So we think it's just going to cause confusion as it is just now.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else got any views on it? Jeremy?
Yes, I'm inclined to be more positive about what was originally proposed as a vehicle for future lettings in the way that the rural economy may go. But to see what is in the bill, actually not even as a new form of tenancy, they're simply offering a draft agreement. That's all it is. It does not create anything new with legal or statutory force. It is simply volunteered out into the field. And the problem with that is, as Gemma has said, anything that then falls within the purview of the 91 or 2003 Acts will just fall under those Acts, be entirely bound by them, and will not have achieved anything in terms that might be new. And the test for that is this agricultural land used in the trade or business used for agriculture for the purposes of a trade or business. You simply get caught. You are back where you started, having done nothing, and all the freedom to use a commercial lease is already there. So this is less than was consulted on, and offers nothing.
So, because that was part of my other question, is obviously that it is different from what was consulted on. So would have you liked to have went back to that approach that they actually consulted on?
I think that would be more beneficial. I think if what is in play is to be made useful, the very basic requirement is that there be an additional clause or section in the bill at this point which excludes these leases from the 91 and 2003 Acts. And that would silence that whole line of critique. Mm-hmm. And people could then know with certainty where they were with the deal they'd struck. At the moment, they don't know. They could slide into the old law. They could think they're out of it and be mistaken. They could think they're in it and be mistaken.
Mm. So more clarity required from the government then?
I think it's a legal barrier between this form of lease and traditional agricultural tenancies. And then that begins to bring certainty to it. We can then try and build something useful out of it.
Okay. Jackie, did you want to come in?
Yes, I just wanted to add, I would agree with what's been said already. I think I want to be positive as well, because I think this provision actually has potential to bring change to the tenanted sector. And I think if it's done properly, it really could make a massive difference. And one of the issues is obviously to make it clear that it sits out with the quite restrictive regime of agricultural holdings. I mean, I'm loath to advocate another form of tenancy relating to land, because there are so many as it stands. But I think there could be a place for sort of a hybrid between an agricultural, a farm tenancy and a commercial tenancy, because farm tenancies are being pushed to their absolute boundaries at the moment. They're very heavily regulated, heavily restrictive tenancies that really aren't suitable for lots of other activities and land uses. But we want to enable tenants to undertake other activities while still having the protections of agricultural holdings. So if we had some sort of a hybrid that we could move those other activities into without the tenant necessarily losing everything. So you could have some sort of a hybrid whereby if a tenant wanted to undertake a new activity that isn't farming, that it could move into one of these more flexible tenancies where the parties could come to their own arrangements for rent, rent review, improvements, all of that sort of thing. And if that activity ceases for whatever reason, it could potentially, as a compromise, move back into the old tenancy. So there are ways of perhaps using these to enable other activity to happen, but for tenants to have to be assured that they're not losing all their protections. And I think that might be helpful, because where we're finding issues within the agricultural holdings legislation is that things are happening that were never intended when that tenancy was entered into. It was entered into between a landlord and a farmer to farmland, mm-hmm. and it's now being tried to be used for lots of other things that it's not necessarily capable of dealing with, particularly in terms from the landlord's point of view, in terms of rent and what can be rentalised, and in terms of improvements and that kind of thing. So this has potential, but I think the bill, I think we need to move away from calling it a model lease. I think we just need to say that we're going to consult on a new form of tenancy. There needs to be an obligation within the bill, I think, for consultation, full consultation with the sector. I know the policy memorandum indicates that there will be further stakeholder consultation, but I think that needs to be the direction of travel.
Okay, thank you. And Christopher, I think you wanted to come in.
Yes, I agree with Jeremy that essentially we would like to see clear water between this proposed lease, new proposed land use tenancy, and the existing Agricultural Holdings Act tenancies. There is a fear amongst tenants that they will be amongst existing agricultural tenants that they will be pressurised into taking on a new type of lease, carving land out of their existing leases and taking it on this new type of lease in order to accommodate, for example, regenerative or climate mitigating measures. As an organisation, that's not what we want. I don't think tenants will be willing to do that because they end up with two different types of leases with mismatching tenures. And I think it's more important for a just transition for tenants that we take this opportunity to make sure that existing agricultural leases are able to, and tenants are able to play their part in the future to engage in the non-agricultural activities that may be conditional on future support in the future, which are the environmental and climate change mitigating options. And that is part of the aim of this bill.
So you feel the government's really taking the wrong approach?
I'm not sure which stakeholders asked for the land use tenancy. I can see there is a role for it outside of agricultural holdings, and it should stay outside of agricultural holdings legislation. It is possible that it may not affect tenants in any way, but there is a worry amongst tenants that the focus is now on might be on encouraging tenants to use this new lease rather than making sure existing leases are fit for purpose in a changing world. And that really is what has brought about this Land Reform Bill Part 2 for tenants is to make sure tenants, existing agricultural tenants, have a level playing field going forward and are able to play their part in all the new options that land managers are going to be expected to undertake.
Thank you. If I can just add to that, possibly, I don't necessarily agree with Christopher that that's what the bill is about entrenching the rights of existing tenants further. I think the bill should be, and states that it is about creating a vibrant tenancy sector. So I think these tenancies could be used to address the exact problems that Christopher's talking about. A lot of environmental land management may need a joint venture, either with the landlord or with another party, to get the activity going. It may not be the natural place for a farmer to undertake activity, and they may not be comfortable without doing that with another partner. And these types of tenancies could exactly fill that gap, that are more suited and can be designed by the parties to suit their individual needs or as joint ventures, for example.
Okay. I think to add to that, and be, I think, more positive again than Christopher in this, this is an opportunity to look at a new form of tenancy for new agreements between new people, between the owners who may no longer feel fit to farm and people who are looking for opportunities to farm, for the expansion of the let sector that Scotland is so sorely lacking, and facing how the rural economy may itself be evolving under climate change pressure and other opportunities. So I think this is an opportunity that we are at risk of seriously missing, and I would far rather look at it in those lights and how we make it fit for the future than, in principle, this is about new rights, new obligations, new duties, new opportunities. It's not about rewriting anybody's existing arrangements. That's for them to choose and agree if they please, but this should be forward-looking, and at the moment it's not rising to that challenge.
So if there were safeguards and protections in...
I actually get enthralled listening to the questions and the answers. My problem is I have other committee members who will be nipping at my
sorry
head. And I was noting there's about 12 sections that people want to go through, or 12 different sets of questions. So There was a kind of a positive and a negative note from Jeremy there. Maybe we could gently leave it there and I could move to the Deputy Convener. I apologise, Douglas, to come in with his questions. Ben.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. And just remind members of my register of interest that I'm on the roll of Scottish solicitors, in case that's relevant in today's proceedings. Thank you for your time. I've got a first question about small holdings. So some stakeholders, such as the Scottish Crofting Federation, feel that small land holdings should be converted to crofts. Other respondents have said there are equally good arguments for bringing these holdings under either crofting or agricultural holdings legislation. The Faculty of Advocates suggested last week to us that from the point of view of legal clarity, it may be more helpful to wholly codify small land holdings legislation without leaving elements of the old legislation in force. Do you have any views on these points, and do you agree with the approach taken in the legislation as drafted, or do you feel another approach would have been preferable? Christopher, first please, and I'll come to you.
Well, the basic options were, should small landholders become crofters, or should they come under the umbrella of the Tenant Farming Commissioner and have legislative modernisation similar to agricultural holdings? There aren't many of them left, and I don't think any of them are here today. But the ones I've spoken to, and I believe Scottish Government officials have met with them, there is far more appetite for coming under ag holdings legislation than the crofting option.
And are you able to evidence that to the committee as a follow-up, perhaps? Or?
Well, all the ones I've spoken to would prefer to become under the umbrella of the Tenant Farming Commissioner. Small landholders at the moment do have a legal mechanism to convert to crofting. It's maybe a complex mechanism. But the ones I've spoken to about whether or not they want to do that and would it be helpful if there was a code of practice for that conversion process. I haven't spoken to all of them, but the ones I know and spoken to don't seem very keen on that idea.
Okay, thank you for that feedback.
I would just add, I haven't got personal experience either of as Christopher has, of small landholders, and I think we need to respect what their view is. You could see them slotting into either regime, but I think what's happened in the bill, there's sort of a hybrid. There are some elements of crofting, such as the 7-yearly rent review cycle, and they're not simply picked up and moved into agricultural holdings, and perhaps that might have been simpler because it is quite a complex tenancy landscape out there, and it might have been simpler to completely move them into the ag holdings landscape rather than we have provisions which are very similar. So they've been given preemptive rights to buy and compensation for improvements and similar provisions and under the Tenant Farming Commissioner, but they're slightly different. So I think it doesn't necessarily create the simplification we wanted. It is very welcome, I think, to deal with the small land holdings issue and to provide them with that codification to an extent. But I think perhaps it would have been even simpler just to pick them up and set them into ag holdings.
So we're broadly content with where the government is going in general on this. There seems a natural alignment with the 91 Act at this point. Indeed, I suspect that over the decades, quite quietly by behaviour of the parties, a number of them have got lost that way and that now may have had that origin but have simply evolved into being 91 Act tenancies. And I think there's a wider point here. It's quite difficult having a regime specifically for just small numbers of tenancies and maintaining the professional infrastructure so that both parties are adequately advised. There is a larger pool of advice experienced in the 91 Act able to assist people than there would be outside the crofting counties for people in crofting. So I would, we favour the 91 Act approach as a broad sense of direction.
Okay, thank you. And Gemma, you want to come in as well?
Yeah, I would agree with what Jeremy said. My understanding is that there's about 60 of these small landholders are left, so it is a really small number, and I think this is an area where modernisation is definitely welcome. We don't have a particularly strong view about whether they should be identified as crofters or under ag holdings, but I agree with what Jeremy said about, you know, the capacity to help them, to support them. I also think the potential for bringing them under the umbrella of the Tenant Farming Commissioner is very positive. That's something that our experience of working with the current Tenant Farming Commissioner has been excellent, and I know that he's been a great support to both landlords and tenants. So from their point of view, I would suggest that that is a positive step forward.
Mary, you want to
just to confirm that we would agree with the approach that Jeremy and Gemma have taken on that front, that there are more knowledge bases available for either crofting or a 91 Act tenancies, and simplifying the process in terms of, if we're already creating other options for tenancies across Scotland, if we're going to protect a small number of tenancies, it would be simpler to have them under one structure.
Okay. Well, thank you all for that feedback. I'll just move on to my next question, which is on the registration of tenants' right to buy. This is a question I asked our panel last week as well, so be grateful for your thoughts on do you agree with repealing Section 99 of the 2016 Act, which removes the requirement for tenants to register their interest in exercising their right to buy, and do you agree with provision for registration to be amended by regulations? Jackie, you want to go first?
We do agree that Section 99 should be repealed. We're not entirely convinced that the new provisions are absolutely necessary, but we do welcome the fact that a pre-registration stage is being retained, because we think that's important in terms of transparency, and that anyone with an interest in the land will know, you know, whether tenants have registered an interest to buy or not. I noticed that the Delegated Powers Committee has written to this committee with some concerns over how wide the powers are in terms of secondary legislation here, and I would concur with that. But as long as those powers are defined enough, and that we know that the purpose is simply the process of registration, then I think that's fine. The one point when we have talked to members and professional advisers is the idea that a plan or a map at this stage of registration is actually quite important. And I know tenants have told us that they feel that's too onerous a burden to have to produce a plan. But when you look at what the potential benefit is to them of acquiring a farm at a severely discounted price, I think that that's not too much to ask, and it can actually avoid disputes down the line if you have some sort of a plan. And if a tenant, we could have a compromise here, you know, if a tenant wasn't willing to provide a plan, then maybe the landlord could do that. But I think there is a necessity to have that at the outset. The reason being, if a landlord wants to sell perhaps a little strip of ground for a substation or something else, and the tenant believes that that's within their tenancy, the landlord doesn't. The landlord could inadvertently trigger a right to buy on that area. So there needs to be clarity to avoid these kinds of disputes arising further down the line. And I think the cost of producing a plan at that stage shouldn't really be onerous or burdensome in the bigger picture.
Christopher, you want to come in as well?
Yes, the tenants have had a preemptive right to buy since 2003. But it requires registration, and it requires that registration to be renewed every 5 years. There are quite a few obstacles to tenants registering, and that's evidenced by the number of tenants who have registered. I haven't checked lately, but I believe it's probably less than 1,000 active registrations in the land registry, given that the Scottish Government figures suggest there are about 4,000 1991 Act tenants in Scotland. It's not a very big proportion of tenants. Tenants are easily deterred from registering. Some landlords are not very keen to see tenants register and will simply say that, more or less along the lines, if any tenants on this estate do register, they will be treated in a different way to those who don't. And that's enough to simply put off an entire estate from registering. And that was the real reason why, back in the Richard Lockhead's review of Ag Holdings in 2014, they recommended an automatic right. Now, I struggle to believe that there are landlords in Scotland who don't know that they've got secure tenants on their holding, but maybe there are some. I can't believe there are very many, but I don't see any reason why there shouldn't be an automatic right. Most tenants have written leases. If they don't have a written lease, then there is still a contractual arrangement there. They're paying rent. Landlords know the extent of the holding. Modern mapping requires really detailed discussion about where a particular boundary is. The maps you see in leases, you know, most 1991 Act leases will be from before the 1960s. The maps that are usually attached to a lease look like something that a child's done with a felt tip pen on a very large scale map. You know, one mark of a felt tip pen, when you look at it, is maybe 40 metres wide around the edge of the holding. Where the next obstacle for tenants is to agree the extent of the boundary, and where we've got lots of members who have tried to register the preemptive right to buy, but they've got nowhere because a landlord keeps objecting to the detail of the mapping. I think the mapping is largely irrelevant because when a tenant does buy their farm, I know of no tenant who's bought his farm where they followed the exact boundary of the tenancy. There's always a bit of negotiating. There's bits that the landlord wants to retain. There's bits that the landlord doesn't want, for example, islands of woodland within the tenancy that the landlord won't want to hang on to. So I'm not aware of any mapping issues preventing a tenant from buying their farm, but it is a problem for registration, and there's a number of reasons why a landlord would not want to agree to the extent of the holding through a detailed map. One of them is because if a tenant is to follow the statutory relinquishment and assignation provisions, a way for a landlord to defeat it is to say that they can't agree to the extent of the holding on a map.
Can I just ask a question? Sorry to interrupt, Ben. When you submit, most farmers will be submitting claims every year, and they'll be using a field identification system as laid out by the government, which I know from experience somebody has walked around probably with a satellite dish to make sure that it's exactly, the cropping is exactly as per the holding. Is that not definitive mapping?
But that won't necessarily be the extent of the land under the lease.
It shows you what fields the tenant is occupying, but then there's an argument. When you get into the modern mapping, which you can zoom into digitally, the edge of the field, there might be a fence, a dike, a ditch, and another dike on the other side of the ditch. Which one is the boundary? If you look at the 1960s map with the felt-tipped pen covers all of that. And if there's a farm road along the edge of it, it will cover that as well. So there's endless little niggles that can easily deter someone from registering. And there are a couple of examples where it's to the advantage of the landlord not to have an agreed boundary. And I think that is one of the reasons why tenants struggle with a registration.
But there is a process in the legislation to resolve that dispute, if there is one. So I think that's not necessarily an argument not to do it.
Yeah, but that requires a submission to the Land Court under, I think, Section 4, and very few tenants are willing to go to that expense of a Land Court hearing to establish that. But there are real obstacles there, and that's why Richard Lochhead's review group, and there were two lawyers on it, suggested that it should be an automatic right. But if it's not going to happen, then we have to look at means of making it happen, making the registration easier if it's not going to be automatic.
Okay, so your clear view is automatic as a preference.
Yes, because
if automatic is not
then tenants are not opting in. They could opt out if they wanted to, but I just think tenants come under so much pressure from landlords not to register, and we've seen the consequences in the last few years. There are a number of estates which have been sold, some sold privately, and the tenants have had no opportunity to buy. And likewise, any interested community group would not have had an opportunity to buy if they hadn't registered.
Again, the legislation should deal with that. We'd be interested to know the examples that Christopher is referring to, because we would encourage tenants to register. I think that's for transparency. That's the best thing across the board. So if we can maybe follow up with examples where Christopher's had to deal with particular issues on particular estates, but I think the broad view would be it's a good thing to register.
You just look at the facts. There aren't that many registrations in the last 20 years, and there's a reason for that.
Okay, well, that was helpful feedback from both of you. Thank you, and good to get some recommendations, particularly based on previous government work. So thank you for that. And any follow-up from either of you, of course, the committee would welcome. Before convener move on to other questions, I don't know if anyone else on the panel wants to add on these points.
In the previous legislation, we supported making the right automatic for tenants. Our understanding is that Scottish Government has said now that it's not legally competent not to have some form of notice, which is part of the rationale for revisiting it in this. We think it's a positive thing that it is being revisited now. And our tenants that have spoken to us, certainly, I can't say that NFUS has any significant evidence of tenants being discouraged, although I recognise Christopher's concern with that. What our tenants have said to us is that they think that if there is a notice, it should be as simple as possible. And I think also it's important to view this through the lens of broader land reform and the objectives around clarity of information and transparency. And I don't think tenancies should sit outside of that.
We appeal at this point of what has appeared to be an unimplementable provision. And I suspect I would stay with Gemma's support for simplicity in this. And I think the question of mapping is when are you choosing to have your argument? When you're negotiating or when you're starting at the beginning? And that seems to me to be something that people can debate.
Just for clarity there, Jeremy, when you refer to repeal, you mean the Section 99 of the 2016 Act?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. Manny, do you want anything? Thank you all. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Ben. We're going to move to the next questions, which are from Jackie.
Convener and welcome panel. Just can I go back just slightly, just for clarity, from Christopher, when you were saying automatic right to buy, are you meaning first refusal?
Is that, yes. An automatic preemptive right.
Just wanted that on the record for clarity. Thank you very much.
I think it's confusing that it's called a right to buy in general, because it's not a right to buy, it's a preemptive right.
Yeah. Thank you very much. My questions are going to be around a resumption, which I know different folk have got different views on. So I'll just start off with a simple one, asking if you agree in the principle that compensation for tenants on resumption or in the case of notice to quit needs to change. Christopher?
Simple answer, yes. It's an historic compensation arrangement at the moment. Whether it's through notices to quit or resumption, it's the same effect on the tenant. They lose all or part of their holding. And the compensation that a landlord pays a tenant at present is so small that it doesn't come into the equation for the landlord as to what his future plans are. There's no consideration by the landlord at the cost to the tenant.
Can I just add, I think certainly on resumption of a part of a tenancy, there should certainly be compensation payable, and compensation is intended to put you back in the position you would have been insofar as money can do it, had it not been for the part of the ground being taken away. I think there is a very different position between what resumption is and terminology is confusing, I agree, because an incontestable notice to quit is when a landlord has perhaps received planning, has promoted a site for planning for development, has received planning permission for a large area and wants to take back the whole farm. Now, the word resume has been used in that situation, but it's not resumption in terms of statute. So that is one situation that is governed by statute. There's a statutory process for when a landlord has obtained planning, wants to develop the whole thing, and the tenant is is given notice to give back the whole farm. And that is a specific situation. And I think there, in practice, in those cases, my understanding is that very few, if any, landlords and tenants will stick to the statutory definition for the heads of compensation. And there usually is an additional payment negotiated. That's very much a horse trade between landlord and tenant. Resumption is a very different thing. Resumption is a contractual thing. So the landlord only has an ability to resume a bit of the tenancy if that's in the lease. So when the lease was agreed, the rent will have been adjusted. It will have been in contemplation of the two parties that a bit of the land might be resumed at a future date.
So when the lease is very first drawn up, mm-hmm. then that has to be in the lease there,
yes,
then, or they can't claim for it later, they can't go for resumption,
yes,
later on.
Yes, so it's a contractual
process. So if you had a family farm that you'd leased in 1960, then resumption had to be in it then before you can actually get it now. Is that what you're saying?
So for the landlord, yes. If the landlord wants to be able to resume any of the land for any purpose.
The modern tenancies,
there's a statute, right? But for the secure tenancies, yes, it's a contractual provision that this bill is now retrospectively changing. So in those situations, the lease would say how long the resumption notice needs to be, how the compensation might be. The compensation is various heads of claim. Now, and I would agree with Christopher, they are very low because they're multiples of the rent, and rents in agricultural tenancies tend to be very low. So there is an argument, certainly, for reviewing that. I think that is as an alternative. And I think what we want to achieve is the policy objectives in the least detrimental way possible. And I think that certainly looking at that multiple would be a way of reviewing compensation, just to ensure that it stays abreast of. I mean, if a tenant is losing a field or a part of a field because a landlord needs it for another purpose, then they will have inconvenience, and we call it disturbance in the statutory terms. You know, they'll have to move fences and gates, yeah, and reorganise themselves. So there's certainly an argument for compensation, but not in the way that it's done in this bill. It's not appropriate for resumption, what's been done in this bill.
So you would agree that it needs changed in the future?
I think there's certainly a view to review it, and I think that can be done, and we can do it in a way that doesn't damage the sector in the way that this is doing.
Okay. The starting point to answering your question is a simple yes. But going on beyond that, the present arrangements effectively date back to 1968. When the law was then amended to add the extra payment, the additional payment, of four times the rent, at a point when rents in real terms were more valuable than they are now, and when there was a much more lively tenanted sector than there is now, and it was intended to assist people to put themselves, find other land, and just manage that movement in a way that is simply now not feasible. So I think we're now in a very different environment. I think there is a clear, if you like, economic case, to put it no higher, that when looking at decisions about land occupation and use, the costs that change in use imposes on here the agricultural tenant are a factor in doing that, and so properly recognising that. The approach taken in the bill is broadly that would be taken for compulsory purchase. So you have the disturbance to the tenant and you have the loss of value of the tenant's interest. And that seems to me to be a valid and useful approach, recognising that. So points then to pick out of that. Firstly, it's the value of the tenant's interest in the tenancy. It is absolutely clear in this, and it will be clear for compulsory purchase and everywhere else, that the tenant has no interest in the landlord's reversion. Any downstream use the landlord might have for the land is not a matter of the valuation of the tenant's interest. And so we're looking at the value that lies in the tenancy to the tenant, and a significant value, and this is shown in tax cases and elsewhere, and compulsory purchase ones, lies in a 91 Act tenancy because of its below market rents. And that is the difference that a tenant now faces. So in a 91 Act tenancy, he has a benefit that he wouldn't be able to replicate in the marketplace. That difference has a value, the profit rent. That gets us, I think, then to the next point, which is that this is then a significant issue qualitatively for 91 Act tenancies. and they've been there for a long time. I recognise Jackie's arguments, but at this point, long-term interests have that the benefit of that. We do not see this as being as relevant or as appropriate for 2003 Act tenancies.
Why not?
Firstly, there are two arguments in this one. The first one is that they will have much lesser value. The simple practical point that they will almost all be at market rents, so there will be next to no value in, or if any value in the interest. The disturbance remains a question, and the cap on disturbance, I think, is something that could be lifted. But the value of the interest in the property is negligible. Secondly, if we are looking, as we touched on earlier on, at a chance of encouraging more people to let, then the point at which you enter into a letting at risk of having to pay back far more rent than you've ever received becomes very problematic. And that seems to me to be counterproductive. So between two pragmatic arguments, I think the balance is quite strongly against extending it to 2003 Act tenancies, but recognising it for 1991 Act tenancies.
We just had a further concern in relation to the significant increase in compensation. It's not really compensation because it's not compensating you for... If a tenant had paid a premium for their tenancy, then yes, they would be compensated for a proportion of that premium on resumption, but that's not the case here. But I think the other issue for the whole rural sector, I think, in terms of discouraging development, because landowners may have incurred tens, hundreds of thousands of pounds in promoting development. And if the ability to resume that strip for the access to the housing development or, for utilities, if that now is going to become very expensive, it could throw all that whole project askew. And also the fact that the legislation is now imposing a one-year notice period, whereas a lot of these resumption clauses will have agreed 2 months, maybe 3 months. So landlords may have entered into agreements with developers or with others, other contractual arrangements, where they assumed they could get the land back for that access strip within 2 months. That's now not going to be possible because there's a 12-month notice period. So I think the impact on existing arrangements could be massive in terms of rural development. Housing, we're in a housing crisis. Some of those developments may be stifled or stopped. So I think the downstream effect of doing this really needs to be considered when there are other ways to look at it. As I said, if we believe the compensation payment is too low, then let's look at that. Let's look at the rent multiplier. But don't just automatically throw in a capital payment that will discourage landlords. I mean, I think the arguments against using it for 2003 tenancies, Jeremy has much more eloquently outlined than me, but there is also that political... These 2003 Act tenancies were hailed as the future of the tenancy sector. These were the ones that were to be safe to use, that we were encouraged to use, and now if we're taking the wheel off those, that could really damage the sector, and I think we need to have that understanding of what it could do. So I think the incontestable notice to quit point, I think that's a point that needs to be taken away and looked at. But to attach capital value to a compensation payment for resumption of part of a 91 Act tenancy really is a step too far. And I think we need to go back to the drawing board on that. Yes, let's review the compensation, but don't bring in something that's been copied and pasted from 2016, the relinquishment and assignation provisions. Those themselves were inserted as a stage two amendment, so didn't get full scrutiny, didn't get the proper consultation that should have happened at that time, and very little was mentioned on valuation at that time. There was a stage three amendment inserted to allow regulations, to allow secondary legislation, because it was recognised this was quite a big change and that it may need to be amended further down the line. There was to be further extensive engagement with stakeholders. I think that still needs to happen. And I think if you look at what Mike Russell said at the time, the now chair of the Land Commission, in his role in government, he said, "I've said several times to the committee that I do not believe the Bill's two declared objectives of providing greater security and more opportunity for tenants and of giving reassurance to landlords can go together in the same package. I think that stands. I think Mr. Russell's words stand as it is. And I think that the recognition back then that this was a new provision for valuers, it needed to be further consulted upon, still stands. It's the provisions in 2016 have never been tested in court. They've never been used because where there was non-agricultural value attached to land, because I suppose it makes sense if a land has been in a 91 Secure Act tenancy, it's not going to be promoted for development in the same way. So to simply lift, copy and paste provisions that have never been tested and put them in here.
And just to be clear as well, of course, the land that you're speaking about is greenfield, and under the local development plans, they would need to be changed if they were going to be zoned for housing.
It depends. It depends.
If I'm very conscious of time, so I don't want the pen from the convener. Christopher and Gemma have still to come in, and they had their hands up. If you don't mind, convener. I'm in your hands.
You're in charge of your questioning session, Jackie. I noticed the witnesses all look very, wave their hand at me.
Yeah.
If you want to get in, look at the questioner. I have little control of them.
I think it would be only fair if I took in Christopher and Gemma so that they've got a chance to answer as well.
Just a couple of points about resumption. Listening to the Lands Commission giving evidence here a couple of weeks ago, I think they're broadly of agreement that the what's in the bill should apply to 91 Act traditional tenancies, but they question the appropriateness of it for the 2003 Act tenancies. So just a couple of things about the 2003 Act tenancies. They're not necessarily people who have been in occupation only since the 2003 Act. Some of these are long leases, LDTs, which previously the family was in occupation under a limited partnership agreement, which was a mechanism before 2003 to circumvent security of tenure. So some people who find themselves with LDTs facing resumptions now have been in that holding for 40 or 50 years through two leases, and there's considerable investment there. So I would urge you to make sure that whatever compensation mechanism is introduced, that it takes those people into account. And the other thing about 2003 Act resumptions is there's no limit by a fraud in the lease. The resumption can be the whole farm or a large part of it. And I know of tenants who are facing resumptions of around about half their farm, half their in-by and all their hill ground on 2003 Act tenancies. But originally those would have been let to the family on limited partnership tenancies. And this is a bit of the Act that I think landlords are not particularly happy with, because it does increase resumption, and you hear the usual story, which is, retrospective legislation won't help future letting of land. But the real barrier to the letting of the land is our tax framework. Nothing to do with tenancies and what's in tenancies. There's nothing wrong with SLDTs or LDTs for letting land. The barriers, certainly to the owner-occupiers who might be looking to let land, is that if they do let land on a tenancy, they lose all their tax advantages regarding trading income, regarding reliefs available for capital gains tax and inheritance tax. So that's why people of all landowners of all sizes are nowadays going down contract farming route or grazing licences and cropping licences, which retain their status as the active farmer. So you're not going to fix the tenancy sector with this bill. It needs the tax framework addressed within which landlords make decisions.
Okay, thank you. And Gemma?
I think this is about balance, and that's what we're most concerned about. We have landlord members, we have tenant members, and we have everybody in between that. I think I would agree absolutely that the compensation that tenants get when there is a resumption does need to be revisited. I think the 5x annual rent is too low, because it is linked in with the rent that they pay. And as has been said, they're generally below market rents. I think this should be revisited, and I think it could potentially be a figure. I mean, the Tenant Farming Advisory Forum already had a wee bit of a chat about this, and the figure that was mooted there was something like the 10x the annual rent. So we would certainly think that that was a balance. I think the idea of passing what could be quite significant capital value from one party to the other perhaps isn't the right balance on this one. So I hope that this one can be revisited. On the subject of extending it to 2003 Act tenancies, we have very significant concerns. We want a healthy and vibrant tenanted sector. Jeremy has already described the sector as palliative care in decline. That's what we are seeing. We view tenancies as a vital opportunity for the next generation of farmers coming through. Land prices are particularly high, so it is absolutely vital that there is a supply there for them. We're not seeing it at the moment. Our owner-occupiers in particular have actually come forward on this one and said, you know, we may be in the situation where we don't have a son or daughter coming on after us. They don't want to farm. We'd love to provide an opportunity in the future. If there is any sniff that we would have to potentially give up capital value to a tenant in the future by giving them a 2003 Act tenancy, we just won't let it. We'll go contract farming or we'll go annual agreement. So I think that's what is really important for the committee to have and hold in their minds, is this is about achieving the right balance.
Okay, thank you.
I would be less troubled about this being a capital payment. After all, if it wasn't for the reliefs from inheritance tax, a Scottish agricultural tenant would be paying inheritance tax on that value of the tenancy after death. So I think it would be recognised for compulsory purchase. Strongly agree with what was said that, firstly, the 12-month notice provision here is inappropriate. It's inappropriate to the practicalities of development, but it also jars slightly with the principle of fair compensation. There's an element of double value at that point that's brought in. The approach to incontestable notices to quit for development should be the same as for resumption, working through the arguments. But again, it's only for the loss to the tenant's interest, no further. And that is where there is a level of chatter around that we're aware of, people looking at more value than the tenant actually has a claim on. And the last point, I think, just simply because I suspect you're going to want to move on, is that the Tenant Farming Commissioner should not, in these circumstances, be a first resort for dealing with these matters. These are overwhelmingly dealt with by agreement, a last resort if necessary, but the poor man cannot possibly want the amount of work that's involved in here, which I think has been massively underestimated in terms of every bit of garden ground that gives up, every little substation, every little bit of this and that, aside from the larger cases that Christopher's referred to. It's an unreasonable load on the roll and totally unnecessary in the circumstances.
You were saying that you thought that the 12-month notice, and I'm deliberately not looking at the convener so you can't give me any trouble, the 12-month notice is too long. But, you know, I know that you don't farm on a yearly basis. You plan up to sometimes a decade or more in advance. So should that be taken into consideration?
Then I think you pay less compensation.
Pay less?
You would pay less compensation if you're guaranteeing that year, because effectively you are now double awarding on this basis. Significant issues around development are looked to deal with on shorter notice than that. Now, I think this is the point of compensation. This is dealing with the genuine intrusion on the tenancy. Choose which you want.
OK. Jackie?
I think the point as well, and I think, having read everyone's evidence, that these provisions, again, should perhaps just be where there isn't agreement between the parties, that the legislation sits as a backstop. Mm. Certainly in terms of the 2003 Act, I think it would be very helpful to clarify, instead of doing what we've done in terms of changing provisions, it would be very helpful to clarify that parties can come to their own agreement on resumption and they can agree whatever they like in terms of compensation. That was the whole benefit of 2003 Act tenancies, that parties could act like grown-ups and come to business decisions themselves. So that would be very helpful. It would also be helpful in the 91 Act that it's where there is, for example, if the lease is silent on notice, then perhaps there could be a backstop here. But yes, and I would agree with Jeremy, because one of the heads of compensation claim is net profit that the tenant might have benefited from for a year. So if there's a 12-month notice, then that is a double counting. So.
I'll finish there, convener, unless anybody else wants to come in before.
As you asked my question, Jackie, I'm going
to
move.
I apologise.
Which, of course, is I know you didn't mean to, but tinkering with legislation, if I may just do that retrospectively, caused all sorts of problems for the Scottish Government. Last time they did it with the Salves and Riddle case, I think, would be the best example, which I guess people wouldn't want to go back to, and was deeply hurtful for a variety of reasons. Changing the legislation, could that have a similar effect? Could you get resumptions going ahead now? on the basis that there might be changes in the future? Christopher.
I think all policymakers since the Salves and Riddle case have been very conscious of breaches of ECHR, and that has resulted in a very cautious approach to tenancy reform and land reform. And I think the measures that are in the bill are balanced. I'm sure they've all been checked for ECHR. So I don't see that being a problem. But it is a risk if someone went to, if legislation went too far. And an example of that would have been the Salves and Riddle case, the legislation around that.
So briefly, Jackie, and then I'm going to move to Mark Russell so you get literally 30 seconds.
Yeah, I would agree that no one in the sector wants to go back to that place. I think the draftspeople of this bill have perhaps drafted it on the assumption that compensation will be based on the permitted use in the lease. There seems to be some talk in the valuation area about whether there could be any element of uplift for development value. And if that was the case, then I think we'd definitely stray into ECHR issues and a massive hornet's nest. So I think if some clarity could be given by the Cabinet Secretary or the Minister during the process, and ideally clarity on the face of the bill, that any compensation will be calculated on the basis of the permitted use within the lease. And I know they think they've covered that with the subparagraph 5, but valuers still seem to be in disagreement with each other.
And Jeremy's made that point. I'm sorry, Jeremy, I'm not going to cut you off. You have made the point eloquently before, and I've noted it. I am short of time, and I'm going to move to Mark Ruskell, who's got some questions. Mark.
Yeah, thanks. So if we can sort of focus a little bit on compensation for improvements, and I'm interested in getting your views specifically on Schedule 5 about whether that actually improves the process for agreeing improvements between tenant and landlord, and also where that, you know, in some of the evidence we've had, there's been a bit of concern about the split between those measures which require notice and those which require consent. So if I can get your thoughts on Schedule 5 and anything about those splits. Okay, I'll go for Jeremy Moody first, please.
Right, thanks. No, we welcome the approach, the broad review and the shift to a principles-based approach here. We lived with a list from 1949 until 2019 that was unchanged and increasingly outdated. We managed interim changes in 2019, but the world is moving so fast and so many changes in technology and other things happening that having a principles-based approach, but here supported by examples, and I think that resolves some of the discussion we had in 2019 when I was urging a principles-based approach, and they said, no, we need to know for certain. Giving examples works well for that. The structure of is it consent, is it notice, or is it not, is the ancient one that's recognised, and wouldn't particularly be looking to disturb that unless there was a more fundamental review going on, which I don't think we're looking to do. The awkwardness in what is proposed lies in Part 4, which is the extra heading around, but is broadly considered as being sustainable and regenerative.
Can I come on to that?
Of course,
actually,
yes.
Because, I wanted to come on to
yes.
that separately.
But the starting point
I'll
is
come back to you
the modernisation of the three parts mm-hmm. is into which parts of four would then slot, as we would have to okay. discuss, is welcome.
Okay, good. So just on Schedule 5, Gemma, did you want to come in and then Christopher?
We would agree with Jeremy's points there, I think. Moving to a principles-based approach is better. It's easier to future-proof it in a way. We're not handicapped by something that's become out of date over time. So I think this is welcome. I think, more conversation potentially on the new Part 4 improvements, but, okay. generally welcomed.
Right. Christopher. And then.
Just echo what Jeremy said. Back in 2019, we argued for a principles-based approach rather than an exhaustive list. The list was updated in 2019. It's already needs updating again. In its current form, which is an exhaustive list, it's been a barrier to tenants undertaking modern improvements for many years. So we welcome that approach. The Part 4 measure in the bill adds an element of confusion because landlords and tenants, for landlords and tenants, it's not clear whether you require the notice given to your landlord or actual consent from your landlord, which is a much higher bar. There is a solution that just to divide them out so they go into part two or part one, which requires consent or notice.
Okay.
So I think that's a technicality, but in the general spirit of what's there, it's sensible.
Okay. Jackie?
I think we can see the sense in the principles-based approach rather than a fixed list in terms of flexibility. Worry slightly about it creating scope for dispute because a tenant may feel something just requires notice, whereas a landlord may feel it should have had consent. So I think we need to be quite clear, maybe very clear guidance on, you know, at what point it tips from, if it's the same activity, but it's just scale that tips it from requiring notice. So we would worry about the possibility for dispute, and we need quite clear guidance on that.
Okay. Marie, did you want to come in?
Yeah, we would agree with Jackie on that front. I think it's welcomed, a welcome change, but it is important that the right guidance is in place for those who are advisers to be able to help landlords and tenants come to an agreement where there may be a dispute about what's happened.
Okay, thanks. And then, yeah, if we can then go to part four then. So this sets out the kind of improvements, sustainable regenerative agriculture. Is the inclusion of that list helpful? And are there things that are missing from that list? I think there was a comment about soil carbon, which of course is going to be hugely important going forward, but perhaps raises a question about landlord and tenant who has access to that kind of resource, who stewards it. Christopher Nicholson, do you want to come in?
Yes, this is the changes to the Schedule 5 are about creating a level playing field for tenants so that they can undertake all the measures and options that they might be expected to undertake in the future that essentially have a non-agricultural element. And obviously soil carbon is an important one. There are already schemes in operation that allow farmers to benefit from soil carbon increases if they're undertaking practices that improve soil carbon. Soil carbon is a vital part of soil health. I think the part four does include improvement to soil health, but I think it needs to quite clearly mention soil carbon so that tenants can undertake schemes that focus on improving soil carbon, which is very much in the public interest because it's carbon sequestration and also improving the health of our soils. Without soil carbon, we wouldn't have any much in the way of topsoil.
Are there other things that in time may be added to that list? I mean, we're in a rapidly evolving situation at the moment in terms of our understanding of carbon sequestration. I mean, we're talking about, you know, salt marsh codes at the moment, yeah. And, you know, blue carbon. And, I'm wondering to what extent, you know, if we're 10 years on from now, we start thinking about new markets, whether this absolutely captures everything. So I'll briefly take you back and then we'll go to Jeremy and then Jackie.
I think it should be possible to make tenancy legislation through the Scottish Parliament fit for purpose for the support schemes, future support schemes that are determined by Scottish Parliament. The more challenging problem for the tenanted sector is how the tenanted sector can take part in the private market schemes, which will be governed by codes of practice. And to date, I don't think the drafting of the existing codes of practice have really looked hard at it from the tenanted angle. We only have two at the moment, the Woodland Carbon Code and the Peatland Carbon Code. In the case of woodland, there's very little leasing of woodlands. It's largely claimed by people who are owners, and I think more thought needs to go into how those codes apply to leased land.
Okay, thanks. Right. Sorry, Jeremy, to cut you off.
Thanks. And part four, in many ways, is a distraction.
Okay.
The issues that you're looking at, and they're important ones, and as Christopher has been raising, are all there effectively to be covered under parts one, two, and three. So the principles-based approach divides. And, of course, what they've done, just to use one very, very long-standing example, probably one that's not been tested for well over a century, is the warping and wearing of land, effectively the management of water meadows. That was in part one. That's now been put into part four. You're left with the argument about where it sits. That almost inevitably is a part one item. Other items you would allocate according to the circumstance and scale, as has been discussed. And the second problem with part four is that it lists items that are potentially compensatable by listing them, but it does not then automatically mean that they necessarily have value. And I think this is a challenge in this area, and some of the issues that we've just been touching on are subject to very considerable discussion and debate in circumstance, and everybody retreats either to saying they're nascent markets or it's the Wild West. But some of these things may actually not have value. They may simply be what is expected under terms of leases and other farming and rules of good husbandry and the rest. So there's a slight error about part four that it's a gesture. It's making a statement, but it's a distraction from real practical purpose.
Thanks, that's useful.
Well, I can see the purpose from the Scottish Government's point of view in part four is to really help tenants to overcome the first barrier when they get to the land court, because it would automatically be assumed that these particular items were beneficial to the environment. I agree with what others have said, that it doesn't fit. It feels like it's crowbarred in, because the first three parts are very clear. It's consent, notice, or nothing, you know. Do go ahead and do the work. So those three things, and these will all depend on, I guess, scale as to which bit they fall into. So it could be, I get the reason for putting it in is almost as guidance to the Land Court to say if a tenant has undertaken these kinds of works, then they automatically pass test one. Mm. But it perhaps, and I take your point that this list may be out of date within a couple of years, and we may need to have other things in it, and there could be things here that aren't appropriate. I come back to what, and it backs up, I think, what Christopher had said, that a lot of these carbon schemes and will require joint ventures. If it's untenanted land, you will require the landlord and tenant to work together if there's permanent land use change happening. So there is certainly an argument for non-agricultural environmental works to be done in a vehicle that is designed for the purpose where landlords and tenants can and come to those agreements themselves together collaboratively.
Yep. Thanks. Gemma, did you want to come in?
I agree with the majority of what's been said there. I think our view is that the part one, two and three, we should stick with that, and part four we potentially don't necessarily need. So perhaps it's about consolidating and then providing additional guidance on this one. But the principle of updating generally and moving to a principles-based approach is something that we definitely do welcome.
Okay. Mary, did you want to come in? No? Okay. Okay, so my final question is raised about the process with diversification and whether you have comments on that, sort of follows on from what we're discussing in terms of environmental improvements. So,
yeah. To repeat what I'd said, that if diversification is of such of a non-agricultural nature and to such a scale that it changes the nature of the what's happening on the land, then maybe let's look at another vehicle to do that. Mm. As Christopher said earlier, the Land Court can sometimes be used as a tool, because it does give a right for the party who has the right to go there, but it's sometimes a dissuasion as well. So the ability of the landlord to object or to have comment or input in a diversification is, I think, in some cases been overridden by the Land Court and leaving it to the Land Court as the last as the way that the landlord has to object or to get involved in a diversification that will make substantial changes. But we completely agree with the principle that diversification is vital for many, many farms and will have to happen for farms to be sustainable economically going forward.
Okay. Okay. If there's no further comments on that, I'll hand back to yourself, convener.
Thank you. I was just trying to find that list of things that are allowed. I seem to remember when I read the bill, osier beds was in there somewhere. I didn't quite understand how you were going to value that diversification.
Part one. Mm. Maybe we could update the lists as well for the part one.
Jeremy, do you want to pass comment on that? I mean, some of the things are quite difficult to understand how there's a value attached to them.
What you are dealing with is a very, very antique list, probably of 19th century origin. And that's why we needed to update it even in 2019, never minding since. The reference to osier beds, in the days when timber and leather were the plastics of the age, the ability to manage a willow bed, to be able to produce material from it, had economic value in 1880. It probably hasn't had very much in most circumstances, except the more unusual ones, for many decades. But it's been carried forward, partly because I think lawyers are draftsmen are reluctant to drop things lest they have meaning, and partly because they've just become so much part of the furniture. But it would be a rare for an osier bed now to have noticeable value, but it could, of course, be short rotation coppice, at which point we would look at it quite differently.
And I think that would be an interesting one to do. I'm going to move on to something probably within the bill, which is compensation for game damage, where there are specific things which allow the tenant to claim against the landlord. Now, there seem to be... I'm not disputing anything about game birds. It's a question of deer when we get into that, because the tenant has a right under the legislation to control deer themselves where they're within enclosed areas, unless they're specifically reserved to the landlord. But the claim, there is the ability for the tenant in the legislation to claim for deer damage against the landlord, even though they have the right to control them themselves. Have I misunderstood that, Christopher?
Yes, the tenant does have a limited ability to control deer through the Deer Act, Scotland 1996. It is a very limited ability. The tenant can only control deer on land that is subject to the damage and where the land is improved land. It doesn't include other lands that might be within the tenancy or out with the tenancy that are the natural habitats of deer. So if you take an example of a tenant farmer with a field of, say, forage rape that might be completely destroyed by marauding deer at night, during the day, those deer are in woods or hill ground, which may or may not be part of the tenancy. The tenant has no right to control deer on that ground. So it's a bit like, as an analogy, it's a bit like telling Police Scotland that they can only arrest or interview a suspect if caught at the scene of the crime. They can't talk to suspects once they've returned home. So it is incredibly limiting. If you have a field that's surrounded by trees, by woodland, the tenant won't have the right to shoot deer in that woodland, and probably doesn't have the right to use that woodland for approaching or stalking deer because they're on land where they shouldn't be with a firearm. So I think a more balanced measure would be to say that possibly the landlord is not liable if the tenant has ability to control deer over the whole holding, and a bit of a buffer zone if there's a large area of hill ground. The ironic bit about this legislation is that while the law says that a tenant can't claim if he has the right to control, the only cases where, which I can think of, where a tenant has made a successful claim is by threatening to exercise that right to control deer. So it's nearly always on sporting estates where there is no real commitment by the landlord to maintain numbers, and there is a sporting interest either with the tenant or the landlord who really does not want the tenant to be shooting any deer at all, and the tenants have only been able to make that claim by threatening to exercise their rights to control deer on in by.
Christopher, that's a very narrow perspective that the deer come from the landlord's holding. I mean, the amount of times where I've seen deer move a long ways to eat rape, and big mobs of them or herds of them, you know, 100 in a rape field at night that have come out of adjacent land, that would fall under the legislation to the landlord to compensate that, and for the landlord to take responsibility for the fixed equipment that was damaged. I'm thinking fences which may be knocked over in the process. Although a march fence, as I'm sure Jeremy will ascertain, is a joint responsibility between the landowners of the two sides of the holding. So I see the principle of what you're saying, if it is just in an oasis or an island where the landlord owns wild animals, but owns the responsibility for controlling the deer and has the ability to do it. But just as the tenant couldn't go into the neighbouring forestry, nor can the landlord if he doesn't own it. Jeremy, do you want to comment on that?
I think you're right on what you've said. Obviously, the origins of this lie in positions where the landlord has reserved rights to control. And so the tenant's ability then, where he has no defence but to make a claim, a reasonable. And I think broadly what's on the table here in the bill is modernising. I think there are a number of questions, particularly around dispute resolution. The critical things are, can you get the evidence ascertained immediately, as soon as possible, so you can actually show that the damage is as said? And secondly, a proportionate means of dispute resolution. In the end, having recourse to the Land Court isn't sensible. So there are practical points around this one, but this should only apply where the landlord is frustrating the tenant from being able to undertake control. But as you say, deer cross the landscape and do so in large numbers, and the landlord may have an equal hostility to the deer that have come in, but if the landlord has reserved rights, then the landlord has reserved rights.
Okay, Jackie, you want to briefly come in and then we'll move on to the next.
It was really to that point that you made, that the landlord may have no control over the deer coming in. I think the principle is fair, that if there is something happening that the landlord has control over, if there may be shooting tenants, and we may need to look at agreements between shooting tenants. Of course, if sporting rights are reserved to the landlord, that will be reflected in the rent as well.
Okay.
So the tenant will pay less rent because there are shooting rights.
It's quite niche, Christopher, and there's a lot of other committee members wanting to come in. So I'm going to move to Jackie with the next set of questions before I move to Sarah. Jackie.
Me? Oh, so it is. My apologies. I thought I'd been done.
question, Jackie, but you didn't.
I'd like to move on to standards, the procedure on standard claims. Many of the folk that have came back to us have suggested that the standard claims procedure should act as a backdrop where a landlord and tenant are unable to reach agreement, rather than something that is up front is followed in every single case. So I'd be keen on folks' views on that. Should it be when agreements can't be reached, or should it be done for everybody to make everybody the same? Christopher.
You need a strong process and statutory background in the law. But if you have that there and people know what the law says and what will happen if you can't agree, that encourages people to agree around the table without following the statutory process. And that is clear to see in the existing legislation. For example, the relinquishment and assignation provisions that were brought in the 2016 Act, my guess is that about 19 out of 20 people, who tenants and landlords who go through that process, do so by agreement round a kitchen table without reference, without actually going through the statutory process, but they know what the statutory process is, and that provides a steer to the agreement. So yes, people should be free to agree, and it's only necessary for the Tenant Farming Commissioner to step in where there is disagreement.
Okay, thank you. We've got Jackie, then Jeremy.
I would agree with Christopher that we should have the backstop in the legislation. I think it is helpful for parties to focus their minds a bit earlier, to start the process earlier. The actual time frames given in the legislation may not work in every situation. They may work in some. So I don't think we should be too prescriptive there, and as Christopher said, allow people to come to their own agreements. I think it needs to be borne in mind that some of the items that need to be valued won't be able to be valued until the day the tenant leaves. So I completely accept the point that payments should be made as quickly as possible, because tenants need to get their, these could be, you know, quite substantial, hundreds of thousands of pounds. They need that money to move on with their lives. But
not all of the claim will be known at the expiry date, and for interest to run on the whole amount from that date is, I think, slightly unfair. So I think there is a percentage, a large percentage of the claim could be known by the expiry date, but not all of it, and interest should run from the point the sum is agreed.
I think we would see, though, the timetable as being completely unreasonable, completely sharing the objective of getting people paid promptly. It effectively makes what should be a backstop a front stop if you're to start the process several months well in advance, because of the circumstances that change between the timetable, the monthly timetables that are set out here, and the end of the tenancy, and that value can only be done as at the date of WAGO, not a prior value may be an overvalue or an undervalue. The timescale of months entails crops that might not be planted, but you want to have there at the end of the tenancy, silage that might not have been made. You have all the issues, particularly as you run into the Martinmas tenancy, of early winter storms that may make a previously valuable building useless. All these various things are coming to this too early. By all means, indicate willingness to have heads of claim and so on and out and begin to look at it. But large parts of evaluation will not necessarily be as they will be at WAGO. And I think that's a real problem with this is the way this is laid out. It is laid out as a, you may be meant as a backstop, but coming to it months earlier, effectively it makes it a front stop, making it quite hard to have the processes that people have suggested they would like, which I would like, of active and voluntary negotiation. I think an alternative to play with, and in a sense building on where present law might be, is to say you have until 2 months after the WAGO date. And at that point, the commercial rate of interest, the statutory commercial rate of interest on debts cuts in. And I think that would be a significant focusing of mind at that point.
Thank you. Gemma, you looked at me just now. Are you wanting to come in?
Yeah, absolutely. This is one of the parts of the bill that we've sort of highlighted as problematic. I would agree with a lot of what's been said. I think the principle here is that tenants that are outgrowing from a tenancy should not have to wait too long to be compensated. And that is something that we support. What we're not clear of is the scale. How often is this actually happening? My understanding is that the Scottish Government at the moment will have that information, and that's something that we've asked for and that we hope will be forthcoming soon so that we can judge just how much this is actually needed. I would agree with what's been said, particularly Jeremy's comment there about this being a backstop rather than the first thing that you should go to. I think we should try where possible with this to encourage situations where parties are able to negotiate within reason. I also think that this is another one of the provisions which ties in the Tenant Farming Commissioner quite heavily, needing to be highlighted. Every single one needs to kind of go to him, and I think we need to question how we use that resource to best effect. So I would definitely have some sympathy for the view that we should potentially revisit the timescales to make sure that they're workable, because the last thing that we want to do is to introduce some complexity that's going to snarl things up further, but that there should be a backstop, and potentially that idea of applying commercial interest rates after a certain time would focus minds.
Okay, grand. And that full answer I got, convener, meant that I don't need to ask my second question. So I'll back into your hands.
Just a question on a period of time after the end of the tenancy. I mean, I think, Jeremy, you mentioned Martinmas and that date. You know, it might be that the hefted flock to the hill are being bought at that stage, but the tub has only just gone in. And if you set it before or too shortly afterwards, you'll have no idea what you're buying, as well as the crop. So is 2 months too tight? Or should it be... Where do you strike the balance is what I'm asking.
Yeah, and that's a very real and challenging question. I put the 2 months out for discussion on the basis that it sits there in the current legislation with the extensions for negotiation. Ultimately, though, of course, you are valuing as at the WAGO date. And at that point, you're taking a view the market would take at that point of the potential as at that date. You are not trying to ascertain a future value any more than you're trying to ascertain a past value. So I can argue whether it's 2 months or 3 months. I suspect if I went longer than that, people would say I was dragging it out. I see a significant interest rate as being a stimulus as when it cuts in to getting people to focus their minds. But I think I do come back to that point. It's a valuation as at the WAGO date, with its potential, with its opportunities, with its risks, not turning on events after the WAGO date when the tenancy has ended.
I mean, my issue, just if you were valuing 500 ewes at Martimus and they were all empty, where in fact some of them could be carrying or potentially in lamb, that the valuation is considerably less than, you know, if somebody's put the ram in and the ram's been working.
Yes, but at some point somebody is having to make an assessment as to how effective that's been.
Difficult one. Christopher, yes. You wanted to add something.
Just a little bit of background. This measure was really aimed at the 2003 Act tenancies. So if you remember, the 2003 Act introduced limited duration tenancies, originally with a minimum period of 15 years. So we started to see the first WAGOs in 2018, 2019, 2020, and it was clear there were issues in how long some tenants were waiting for payment. That's a problem for tenants looking to retire, because they need to work out if they can afford to buy a house or not, and they have no clarity at the point of the end of their lease as to what their WAGO compensation will be. It's even more of a challenge for a new entrant who's coming out of a, say, a 10, 15-year lease, and they've got to go mid-career to another farm. They need to know what kind of capital they have available to plan that move. And the only way to get there, so that there's clarity about that at the end of the tenancy, is to start those negotiations earlier. Now, I know there's quite a bit of comments from agents about some of the timelines. I accept that. But there's no harm in starting the negotiations earlier. And where the big arguments are tend to be for large items of fixed equipment like buildings, which are unlikely to change much in value over the course of 6 months. Unless there's a storm or something like that, but that's an unusual situation. So if they made a start with the big items that are unlikely to change, or if they do change a little bit, but you can argue it, that is giving a bit of clarity for the tenant as to where what funds they will have available, whether it's for retirement or moving.
So, sorry, the other thing, just it's a long time since I did all of this, so I'm probably well out of date, but is it still the situation where incoming tenants pay the outgoing tenants for the benefits that they're going to accrue when they take on the lease, or is it just all straight at landlord level? Jeremy?
If there's an incoming tenant, then classically they would pick up the payment to the outgoer.
Yeah,
and they are assessed at value to the incoming tenant.
Yeah,
but of course there are only so many circumstances where there is an incoming tenant.
Okay, so do you think there should be a different? Should there be different for landlords and tenants, or should it be the same for both?
I think the problem is we keep coming back to it. It is a valuation as at WAGO.
Okay,
that is the date. I'm entirely happy with Christopher's notion that we enter into earlier discussions, but if the buildings are burnt down 5 days before WAGO, the buildings are burnt down 5 days before WAGO. They're not there to be taken to.
Okay. Christopher, do you want to briefly add anything?
Just to say that where there is an incoming tenant, and it still does happen, there have been a number of cases of incoming tenants, and typically they will take on from the outgoing tenant stocks of silage, standing crops, etc. But the landlord will be paying the outgoing tenant for the improvements that they've made in terms of fixed equipment, which is where the disputes happen. And where the biggest risk is to the tenant.
Okay. So it's fixed equipment.
I think it's fixed equipment, which you can start talking about 6 months in advance. You can't start talking about what's in a silage pit before.
Okay. So silage is made. UMVs, all the rest of that just can wait till the day. But fixed equipment, that's helpful. I'm going to move straight to Sarah now. You're next, Sarah.
Thanks very much. Yep, I think I volunteered to do the issue of rent reviews, which I think we're now at. And thanks to everybody for the evidence on this. There's quite a lot to unpick here, I think, though. I mean, earlier we talked about disagreements on tenants' right to buy and registration and not being implemented. And then we've got these 2016 provisions, which have never been brought into force. And I want to kick off with Christopher about anything you think is missing from this in terms of practically how this is actually going to work.
Well, the rent review provisions that are in a bill are come from a paper by Bob McIntosh, the Tenant Farming Commissioner. He made these recommendations back in, I think it was August 2020. So we've had quite a long period to think about them, and it was, I'd say there was it was fairly thoroughly studied, and I'm confident that they will work. These similar provisions work well in other countries. What we've got at the moment is completely outdated and unworkable. There is one element that's missing in addition to the actual rent test, which is dispute resolution. I think this bill provides a good opportunity to include a statutory mechanism that allows a rent to be set by an expert arbiter without the risk of appeal to the Land Court. The Land Court, as far as I know, has only set three rents in the last 20 years. People don't want to go there just because of expense, and it would be a huge help for rent reviews to have the ability, where there is a dispute, that the default goes to an expert determination without appeal to the Land Court. And bear in mind that when a rent's set, either party only has to live with it for 3 years before they can serve another rent notice. So I don't see really the need for allowing an appeal to a higher court. It should be a cheap and effective dispute resolution. But there are some elements in the bill that need to be copied and pasted from the 1991 Act. As stakeholders, we thought they were just going to amend the Section 13 of the 91 Act, so that would have only taken a few lines of amendment. But instead, they're working with the 2016 Act, and there are important disregards to do with tenants' improvements, dilapidations, the fact that the tenant's in the holding, also to do with publicly funded grants. That needs to be copied and pasted across from the Section 13 of the 91 Act. I just think that's an omission. I don't think that is controversial, and I don't think it's a difficult amendment to make.
And I think one of the other suggestions you made was about related earnings capacity. Is that something you'd want to raise at this point?
If you go back to the recommendations in 2020, I think it does relate to the earnings potential or earnings capacity. In other countries, that is a factor taken into a rent review, which is the productive capacity and related earnings capacity. My fear is that if you just stick with productive capacity, you're back in a place where we were with the original 2016 Act, which didn't work, which focused purely on output. And rent is paid out of profit, not out of output. And if you don't refer to the related earnings capacity, the focus is on the wrong part of a budget. The focus should be on what the divisible surplus is after all the costs associated with farming.
Thanks. I kind of wanted you to explain that and put some of that on the record.
Productive capacity is simply looking at what a farm can produce, and it's ignoring all the costs of production.
Yeah, thanks. And Gemma, do you want to come in on this issue?
This is an interesting one. This is perhaps going back a step. Previously, it was agreed that productive capacity was the best way to look at rents. The Scottish Government has carried out a huge amount of work on this. They've had external contractors do modelling on it. I think where we've got to now is a sensible place. There's been a lot of stakeholder engagement via the Tenant Farming Advisory Forum. And as Christopher said, the Tenant Farming Commissioner did do a really useful paper on this one. I would agree with Christopher's comments on the potential for introducing something for dispute resolution. I don't think parties should absolutely have to go to the Land Court every time. Mm-hmm. And I think his points there about emissions I would agree with as well. So this is the end of a very lengthy conversation that has been ongoing since 2016. And I think that likely landlords and tenants will welcome getting to a point where there's a bit more clarity.
That's really useful. And I don't know if the other witnesses would like to come in on this. Yeah, the hands have shot up.
All of them.
Yeah. Jackie, do you want to go first, then Jeremy?
I would completely agree with what Christopher said as well. And in relation to a simpler and quicker dispute resolution, if we can have one where the rent can be used in future for comparables, that it's not necessarily a private issue. But Jeremy will have a view on that. To me, that was the only downside of having a binding arbitration, that the rent couldn't be used then as a public figure. We've talked about in Tenant Farming Forum about some sort of a rent register. If that was ever possible, that would be very useful. The other thing that we think is missing from rent review, I completely agree with Christopher as well, in terms of this has been done the other way around to what we expected. So there is a need to really look at Section 13 and make sure that the things Christopher has picked up, that there's nothing else being missed. The one thing we think is missed, and I was looking back at old TFAF papers from January 22, when the Tenant Farming Commissioner asked Scottish Government to look at the treatment of housing and rent review, and they failed to do that here. We have lots of housing legislation coming down the track at us, which will require improvements to houses on tenanted farms. The legislation for agricultural holdings treats houses as fixed equipment, and nobody is obliged to improve anything, neither the tenant nor the landlord. But if they choose to improve it, then there are provisions for compensation or rentalising that improvement. But houses are different. They're not sheds. They're not silos. They're not slurry stores. They're places that people live. And I think it needs to be clear where improvements are required by a separate piece of legislation to a house, that can be dealt with properly at rent review, because insulation won't increase the productive capacity of your farm, but there may have been a significant cost incurred in upgrading or improving a property. So there needs to be proper provision in this bill to ensure that that's dealt with fairly across the board, and whether it's the tenant that carries out the improvement. And I think the provisions we have for compensation for improvements do specifically deal with dwellings and will cover tenants adequately, but I think that needs to be looked at to make sure it's fair. But specifically landlords, if they are the ones required to invest, then they should be able to rentalise and get a return.
So your recommendation would be to amend this section of the bill?
Yes, I would, and I know there's a provision for further regulations, but I would make it clear now, because as of 27th of March 27, all houses will need to be at the repairing standard. So, and there may be some of these houses may be in poor condition, and even the repairing standard might require improvements, if you know what I mean. So I think it needs to be clear in this that if there is obligations imposed by another regime of legislation, that it's dealt with.
It's a bit of joined up thinking.
Yes, exactly.
And it's, we don't want
it's not a new issue. We have been talking to housing folks and Ag Holdings folks for years on this, and it needs to join up now.
Yes, so it's
a unique opportunity with two bills.
Sarah, would you just excuse me for 1 minute? Because there's a word that you said in there, binding arbitration, which means that once you're signed up to it, you take the outcome whether you like it or not. The two previous witnesses said arbitration, which means that if you don't like it, you can go to somebody else. Can we just confirm, are we all talking about binding arbitration?
Yes.
Rent reviews.
Yes, you only have to live with it for 3 years.
So you're saying binding arbitration. Sorry.
Yes.
It's different to arbitration in my understanding of it. Jeremy may correct me, but sorry, Sarah, to interrupt.
No, detail's important. Yeah, did you want to come in then, Jeremy?
Yes, I could, and we'll pick up on that in dealing with this. I think the first point to make is that the provisions in the 2016 Act have proven to be unimplementable, and we have had then to spend a long period of time talking our way through all of this, and that is where it's a slight surprise that we are working from the basis of an unimplemented piece of legislation than a piece of legislation that we actually have worked with over the years and understood and amending that. So it's slightly ethereal working against a piece of effectively non-legislation that hasn't been tested in practice as the basis, but that's where we are. It is significantly improved the load, placing all the load of assessment of rent review on one factor alone, as the 2016 legislation did, was simply not practical for the circumstances of farms. This allows a wider range of load-bearing pieces in the structure to be able to take the strain and help arrive at answers. So this is a welcome development from where we have been. The omission in this bill that is distinctive, and it comes from the way the legislation has developed, is by omitting the disregards, the important disregards that are very ancient disregards that have been there in almost any other rent review provision you can think of in statute, in agriculture and elsewhere. 13.3a in 91 Act terms for tenants' occupation, 13.5 around improvements, and 13.7 for dilapidations. And those all should be on the face of the bill. There is no need for regulations around them. They should simply be on the face of the bill. I would take Christopher's point around productive capacity. I would, and the right way through this, talked more generally of the tenant's capacity to benefit, because there is residential benefit in many tenancies, as well as opportunity to profit. But it is that capacity for the tenant to benefit for which a rent should be paid. And in the end, when you strip away all statute, what rent review arguments boil down to are two questions. What's this worth to me as a prospective tenant in the marketplace, and what are other people paying? And all this is putting flesh on those bones. So, but this is very definite progress. Again, as with everybody else's, I think you've gathered effective unanimity around the notion of, and I would confirm, final and binding arbitration. This is the point about arbitration. It is in principle final and binding. There are quite specific provisions under construction legislation for non-binding arbitration as a means to keep cash flow going there as adjudication. But here, and indeed under the Arbitration Act 2010 in Scotland, arbitration is expected to be final and binding unless people choose that it not be. So we start from that default premise, which is where I think we were all taking it for granted, the point that you've now made express. And proportionate resolution right the way through this, I think, is a significantly important matter, and it's something which CAV and SAVA have set their hand to over the years and worked up the models and looked at this, and the opportunity to learn from the 2010 Act, possibly either by extending it, recognising where we are under Section 17 for statutory arbitrations, or, and perhaps more appropriately for this legislation, simply to amend the 1991 Act so that it no longer has recourse to the Land Court. Arbitration can then be final and binding, but with the safeguards around the questions where something of complete failure of procedure has happened, as you would have in the statutory, the Scottish arbitration rules, and I think you could simply invoke them into this framework. So I think all these questions are soluble, and on the question that was then referred to me from Jackie, at this point, I think we would be moving into a world where awards become public, and that gives us a common law sense of precedent for people understanding arguments, the flow of the marketplace, which arguments have worked, which haven't, and we can build on precedents in the way that we can at the moment from the Land Court, but we can't with the statutory confidentiality that is distinctive in Scotland for arbitrations. And I think this is where perhaps we again come back to modifying the 91 Act rather than applying the 2010 Act for this. But overall, this is an improved package. It should have the disregards. It should have a proportionate means of dispute resolution. But this is vastly, vastly better than the unimplementable work of 2016.
Okay. Does anyone else want to come in particularly about trying to get arbitration that works rather than having to go to the Land Court and it being very expensive? Is there support available or is there something that we need to see to support negotiations between tenants and landlords? Is there something that would make this work better? Or is this going to be enough in terms of what's in the bill at the moment?
What could be added to the bill, as we've outlined from here, would be enough. This is a subject on which we are doing a lot of work in terms of encouraging early effective negotiation, of using early neutral evaluation as an opportunity to take an early opinion before people get too entrenched, the red mist comes down and they lose perspective. And then we have worked up models for what we would call effective arbitration, for the active arbitrator using the powers that an arbitrator has to drive process, to focus on the points that really matter. The Roxburgh and Elliott, one of the three cases that went to the Land Court, they spent ages boring the Land Court witless on budgets when they said, There's no need. This wasn't material. It was all unnecessary cost and effort, adding to the pain of it all. And at the end, the Land Court then said, they said an inappropriate metaphor, this could all have been done with a broader brush and a lighter touch. And that's what we would rather have, is effective focus on the issues. Get to an answer. Parties need answers early. It's like the WAGO discussion. People need answers to get on with their lives and businesses. We see arbitration properly delivered as the means to do that.
Right, Jackie from SLE, you were keen to come in then, Christopher.
Yeah, I was just going to make a point about the role of the Tenant Farming Commissioner here as well, because the Tenant Farming Commissioner has developed a code of practice, and I think that can also be used, because that will set out behaviours and ideal timescales and that kind of thing. And I think where either one or other of the parties is deliberately acting in a way to frustrate that process or to delay things unnecessarily or unreasonably, then I think there could be some sort of comeback in terms of costs or in some other way. But I think the Tenant Farming Commissioner's Code of Practice has a role here too, to try and help the process run smoothly and without unnecessary delay or either party acting vexatiously.
I think I can just respond on that very quickly, just to take that point forward. The arbitrator has powers, unless the parties instruct otherwise, jointly, the arbitrator has powers to cap costs, to control costs, to propose mechanisms for costs, to drive procedure in the directions that an arbitrator gives. Proper use of those powers so that we have purpose rather than process is, I think, essential to doing this. And the tools are there. It's getting them to be used.
And Christopher, do you still want to come in?
Yes, there is a role for the Tenant Farming Commissioner and the Lands Commission here, not just through codes of practice, but the establishment of a panel of Lands Commission-approved arbiters or experts to determine rent. And I think we should use this bill as an opportunity to extend dispute resolution to other areas. An example would be, you know, determining whether a particular Schedule 5 improvement is an eligible improvement or not. And also going back to what Jackie was saying about statutory legislation cutting across the tenancy sector from outside of agricultural holdings, that's nothing new. The most recent one, which will be impacting the farm sector at the moment, will be the rules and regulations around slurry and silage storage and fuel storage. I've forgotten the names of them, but they are a draconian expense to farmers. And there are numerous other examples of statutory legislation, health and safety, asbestos, etc. And in our view, the rent test can cope with that. And you only have to look at some of the textbooks on rent, both in Scotland and in England, to see that there are ways of dealing with that that exist in our rent test.
Can I just come back on that? I would agree with Christopher. If the NVZ regulations mean you need a bigger slurry store and your landlord helps pay for that. But I think that is a clear connection with the productive capacity of the farm. I do feel housing is different and it needs to be clear, because it's not at the moment.
It's not. I don't think any of these statutory requirements increase your productive capacity. If they did, people would be doing them under their own free will without statutory.
If you're not operating legally, you can't operate at all.
Yeah.
It's out into a discussion between yourselves. I would remind you the committee are here, and I'm going to, on that basis, going to push you back to Sarah, who's rapidly going to ask her last question, so I can go to Bob, who's been very quiet during the whole meeting.
Yeah, I mean, I think what's interesting is even just in this discussion, getting agreement on this is really not 100%. And if we're talking about arbitration, it's having those rules and that support and making sure what's on the face of the bill is going to help this and be clear going forward. I think that's what's coming to me. I don't know if either of the other witnesses want to come in on this issue. No? Okay. So it's just making sure that we've got the right framework on the bill. And we've talked about rent reviews. There's been a discussion on improvements, game damage, diversification. Is everybody happy with the way this is framed so that you would get that process of dispute resolution without actually having to go to the Land Court? Just to get clarity on that although it doesn't sound 100% in agreement, people are broadly happy with what's on the face of the bill. Is that right, as proposed?
Yes, everything's there that we expected to be there. But as I think Bob McIntosh suggested in his evidence, that there needs to be a bit of tinkering. As a as stakeholders, we weren't consulted on the detail, we were consulted on the principles, and there are a few surprises, for example, in the way that the new rent test has been attached to the 2016 provisions and not the 1991 Act.
Right, I think that's useful to get on the record, because this thing about detail is critical, isn't it? Given all the different pieces of legislation that are being referenced, and for people to negotiate this in the future, making sure what's in the face of this bill that relates to previous legislation or is new, it's going to need to be clear. That's prompted a comment from Jeremy.
Right. It reminded me of a point that's occurred to me on previous rounds of legislation, particularly in an area that is relatively complex and detailed, like agricultural tenancy legislation. You know, we're spread across several acts and quite a lot of statutory instruments and one thing and another. The merit, indeed, perhaps, of the committee instructing, if it is able to, a technical review of what the wording drafted actually means. There are conflicts in some places between the memoranda themselves and with the bill. There are various points where not, you know, we've highlighted, both in submissions, collectively, all the bodies here, points where the wording is not clear or other things might be picked up. I think with the importance of this and just then the two stages to come after this in the Parliament, that as much precise scrutiny is done as of principles, because ultimately, we as a sector are going to have to live with, make livings, draw rent, advise on these issues. And the more that stage one can be used to try and look at this technically, I think the more it will be beneficial for us.
To finish on, because it feeds into the previous comment from Christopher about not necessarily being consulted in all the detail in advance. So this is what this committee's questions are all about, is making sure we get all this on the record so that the committee can consider it in the report the committee will come up with. So that is all the questions from me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Bob, I commend you for your quietness for the meeting, and now the floor is yours.
Thank you, Convener. Can I apologise to witnesses? There's no lack of interest here, but there's the existence of a blinding headache that I have right now, so hence why I've been so passive during the evidence session. But I've hopefully picked a small political forum part of the bill that we can get some evidence on, and that's in relation to changes there's going to be on rules for good husbandry and estate management, which have not changed since 1948. My notes tell me, and I understand the reason we're changing on this occasion, is it may cut across reforms to agricultural support and the four tiers that are going to be introduced, in particular tier two, where enhancing the level of direct payments will be brought in, and there could be a conflict between meeting lease obligations under current rules and getting the relevant payments on Tier 2. I know that the Scottish Centre Farmer Association have made some comments on this and written evidence, but I wonder if Christopher Nicholson would like to see whether he thinks the changes that are proposed are adequate, and is there anything else that you would quite like to see?
So I think the changes in the bill are adequate to allow tenants to take part in whatever future non-agricultural options might be part of the conditions of our rural support scheme going forward. And to do that, you do require changes to the rules of good husbandry and good estate management, bearing in mind that they were drafted at a time when you had food rationing and farmers were encouraged to grow three blades of grass where there was one before without any consideration for the environment. But I do think this is an opportunity to give tenants a balancing measure where you have a landlord who is in breach of his obligations, whether under the rules of good estate management or other obligations, there is no real useful balancing measure for the tenant. Even going to the Tenant Farming Commissioner, there is nothing the Tenant Farming Commissioner can do to help some of those situations. And there is no real useful mechanism for the tenant to deal with a landlord who's in breach of the rules of good estate management. If a tenant's in breach of the rules of good husbandry, the landlord has measures available to him, and the agricultural textbooks are full of case law examples explaining all that. But there is little a tenant can do where a landlord is in breach of the rules of good estate management. In fact, its only use to a tenant is in defence of an allegation of a breach of the tenant's rules of good estate husbandry. So I think there needs to be a balancing measure there. There is a balancing measure in the 2016 Act, which has not been commenced yet, which is the forced sale where landlord is in breach of his obligations. And I think if that was commenced, it's not a mechanism that was designed to force landlords to sell. It was a mechanism that was designed to ensure that landlords meet their obligations under the terms of the lease. And if that was commenced, I think we'd see much better behaviours and relationships in the tenanted sector.
Can I check, Christopher, then, is your position that you're content with the balances struck within this piece of legislation, but on the basis the provisions within the 2016 Act are actually brought forward?
Yes, if it's brought forward, then that is a key balancing measure that tenants need.
Is there anything specifically within, because there's a three-stage process, of course, amendments at stage two and stage three, is there anything specifically within this Act that you think is not in the bill that would be advantageous to have within the bill?
Well, I think it would be advantageous to expand on the rules of good estate management to include some of the issues, more recent issues that have developed that tenants are faced with, and examples would include deer management. There is a big reluctance amongst a certain group of landowners to engage with deer problems.
Right. Okay, that's helpful. I saw in my notes that Gemma Cooper, that I think there's been comments from yourselves in relation to this area. Is there anything you want to add in relation to this? Is there anything missing from this? Does it get the balance correct?
Our comments generally on both sections, the good husbandry rules and the good estate management, is that we were broadly content. I'm interested in Christopher's comments there about the 2016 Act provision that hasn't been enacted. So this is sale where a landlord is in breach, and reflecting back on discussions at the time, that was very much to be used as an absolute worst case scenario. And I'm also thinking in my head about going back into part one, which I know we're not here to discuss today, but that hooks into the land rights responsibilities statement. A new commissioner for the Land Commission who will have powers to levy sanctions of up to £5,000. So I think there maybe is other mechanisms coming through potentially part one that could help. I think if Scottish Government is to bring forward that provision from 2016, that's going to need significant stakeholder engagement, because I know that they did put it on the face of that piece of legislation, but they did have ECHR concerns at the time. So if they're going to look at that further, that needs a lot of work and a lot more thinking before it happens, and there may be other mechanisms that can be useful. But in sum, we didn't have significant issues with either the good husbandry rules or the good estate management rules. Again, we recognise they need updated, and we welcome them coming forward in a newer format.
Could any other witnesses have a comment to make on this, Jackie?
I didn't have a huge comment. We just had worries about the tie-up and the definitions between this and agriculture. We're now looking at efficient, sustainable and regenerative farming, so it might be quite difficult to have all three. Secondly, the lack of definition, and I completely understand why there isn't definition on the face of the bill, but the explanatory notes indicate that that's because a definition will come through the Code of Practice under the Agriculture and Rural Communities Bill. But there's no, we need to be able to understand this bill within the four corners of this bill. So if a definition is in a different piece of legislation, that means nothing to the definition in here. So there maybe needs to be some cross-referencing in here to the definition in another bill so that we have consistency.
Can I check, Jackie McCreary, is that about a lack of clarity then? Are you content with the definition contained within another bill which recently passed in this place, didn't it?
Yeah. We don't have a definition yet, so we're passing legislation on something that we don't know what it means yet, but the reference in the explanatory notes was that a definition will come later. But that's going to be in a code of practice under a separate piece of legislation. So we may need to cross-refer here that the definition of sustainable and regenerative agriculture is the same definition as the one under the code of practice.
So your concerns are we're passing a bill here without the clarity for what that will actually mean in practice?
Or at least the guarantee of consistency in definitions between the two pieces of legislation.
Right, that they actually connect with each other mm-hmm. in a meaningful and coherent way. That's very helpful. Jeremy Moody?
Yes, thanks. I mean, in principle, we're content with what appears relatively gentle modernisation of these rules from the late 1940s. But I think Jackie has touched on quite a significant point in that, as I recall the debates around the agriculture bill, it's precisely the problems and the extraordinary difficulty of defining sustainable and regenerative agriculture is the reason why that bill is not providing one, but leaving it to be discussed in general terms in a code of practice. In the sense, it won't be a definition, it'll be an illustration, it'll be a guide. And I think you are dealing with concepts here that are actually really impossible to define on any sustainable medium-term basis.
I mean, obviously, I wasn't part of the scrutiny of that other piece of legislation, but just hearing from yourself what Jackie McCreery said, this definition could change over time as practices change, so it makes sense to have this within a code or secondary legislation and keep a watching eye on that. Does that not make sense, I suppose?
Yeah, and I think that's where we are, is that this is something that will not have a definition. It'll be a mood, it'll be a process, it'll be an understanding. It won't be anything concrete.
Okay, I suppose the last thing I would ask you, Mr. Murray, whenever I hear the expression relatively gentle, it probably makes me think, is it a bit too modest? Is there something more you would like to have seen?
I think it depends how much stress you're trying to place on these rules. They have surfaced periodically in tenancy law. When they were drafted, they were meant much more widely on owner-occupiers and all at the time. They surface amid other arguments. You could look more widely at other environmental issues and so forth, but that's a matter of policy, I think, to play with. It's what's on the table serves a purpose.
Right. OK, I stand by faint praise there. Just before my final question, I suppose, Mr. Nicholson, I think you're alluding to, and it's always dangerous asking a question when I'm not quite sure myself the background to this, but you were suggesting that there are set processes just now where if good husbandry has not been followed, there's remedies a landlord can take to get a resolution to that. But if there's not good estate management, then there's not really an equitable or balanced process in relation to that. Is there anything more that this bill can be doing in relation to that?
I think there's two things. One, and I think Bob McIntosh touched on it when he gave evidence, is giving slightly more powers in the future, statutory powers, to the Tenant Farming Commissioner to deal with these difficult cases. The linking failure to meet the rules of good estate management with the sale where a landlord is in breach provision. And I don't know if it's possible in the bill to put in an amendment that gives a time frame for the introduction of that measure. I think that would acknowledge that it hasn't just been parked in the long grass and that it will be looked at, will help behaviours.
I nudge slightly because Jackie McCreery wants to come in and make a comment.
I was just going to say that no one around this table is here to defend poor behaviour by anyone, so I think there is an argument certainly that any penalty that there is for any provision in the bill needs to be proportionate, and I suspect that's where the issue of that provision not having yet been enacted yet comes, because there needs to be a proportionate consequence for poor behaviour.
I think it does seem like a clear option, that 2016 provision, so I think that's very helpful to put on the record. No further questions.
I think we've run out of time, which is annoying because I had one further question, but I'll let you write in if you want, because my further question was, at the beginning of this you said that this was not going to create any more agricultural tenancies. I would like, if you would consider it, just to give a note of what you think might create more agricultural tenancies. Just one idea from each of you would be very helpful. Very happy to take that as written post this committee meeting. And if you crib Lord Gill's words to make agricultural tenancies simpler, I'll know where that's come from. So on that basis, thank you very much for the evidence that you've given this morning. It's very helpful. We will be moving back in post-recess into looking at land reform again. We're not quite sure at this stage when we will take that up again, depending on other legislation. So thank you very much for the evidence you've given this morning. And I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to depart, and I would ask committee members if you could be back here at 11:25, would be very helpful to me. I suspend the meeting. Thank you, and I welcome you back to the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee meeting. We're now going to move on to agenda item 3, which is UK subordinate legislation consent notification. This is consideration of a Type 1 consent notification relating to a proposed statutory instrument, the Persistent Organic Pollutants Amendment Regulations 2024. On the 21st of May, the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Energy notified the committee of the proposed UKSI. The instrument will involve the UK Government legislating in a devolved area of competence and is seeking the Scottish Government's consent to do so. As you'll recall, we discussed our approach to consideration of this UKSI on the 11th of June. We agreed to write to the Scottish Government and to some stakeholders to seek their views on the proposal, and the Scottish Government's response is provided in the annex to the committee's papers. Other responses were circulated to the committee members on Friday. The committee's role is to decide whether it agrees with the Scottish Government's proposal to consent to the UK Government making these regulations within the devolved competence and in the manner that the UK Government has indicated to the Scottish Government. If members are content for consent to be given, the committee will write to the Scottish Government accordingly. In writing to the Scottish Government, we have various options to draw matters to the Government's attention, pose questions to them, and or to be asked, kept up to date on relevant developments. If the committee as a whole is not content with the proposal, it may make one or two recommendations which we could come to. So I just wonder if any members have any comments they would like to make on this. Mark, your comments, please.
Thank you very much, convener. And I should say that in this example, I'm not content for consent to be given. I do believe that the Scottish Government should be legislating in this area to ensure maximum alignment with the EU approach and the EU regulations in this area. It is quite clear that these persistent organic pollutants are a danger to human health and to the environment, and that we should be aiming to drive them out of our environment as quickly as is practicable. I think the European Union's approach to this has been wise. They've fully considered the precautionary principle, the fact that there are numerous hazards and risks associated with these chemicals, and as a result they're proposing effectively two limits, one in 2025 and then further regulatory action at the end of 2027, allowing industry and the waste management sector to make adjustments to how they deal with these toxic chemicals. I do believe that that's the right approach. And I've reviewed the response that we've had from the Cabinet Secretary and from other stakeholders. And I don't see a clear reason to diverge from that European Union thinking. The European Union has done work not just on the precautionary principle, but they've also assessed the economic impact of driving regulation in this area and also some of the economic questions around adjustments to waste disposal, and they've still come to the conclusion that they need to increase regulation and drive these chemicals out of use. So I don't see a reason for Scotland to be diverging from the environmental regulations of the European Union. We're now 8 years from Brexit. If we were still in the European Union, of course, we would just be adopting these regulations as a matter of course, with some oversight from this committee, but there would not be a proposal on the table to diverge from the good work of the European Union. And I believe that given the policy of the Scottish Government is to remain in alignment with the European Union, I think this is a key area where I want to stick my neck out and say that I'm not content with diverging from European Union policy on this area, which is about fundamentally about protecting our human health and protecting our environment.
So, OK, very much noted. Sarah, do you want to come in?
Yes, thanks very much, Convener. I had a couple of comments. I think we could have had more information on this, and it feels like this is flying through. I think there were two stakeholders I wanted to particularly reference in terms of comments I think are important from the committee. Environmental Standards Scotland, the issue about indicative timelines for reviews or setting lower limits is really important to make sure that industry and regulators have got appropriate notes to plan for their adoption. And I think that's really important about monitoring the impact of this change and whether we do need a lower limit in Scotland or not. And I also particularly wanted to see on the record the Chartered Institute of Waste Management Scotland's comments, because they had comments that we need to have a review of the approach to persistent organic pollutants that considers all aspects of risk to human and environmental health so that we don't have any unintended consequences that don't impact negatively on other important areas. And they're suggesting there's significant cost and environmental burden in the proposed approach, and that we really need to see the human health risks properly addressed and analysed that are still to be investigated, and very much support the principle of a short life industry working group, because it's not just whether or not this goes through, this needs to be followed up and we need to have more action so that there's information and so that there's monitoring of what's happening here, and that we particularly draw on expertise in Scotland, but that we actually then link up with the rest of the UK so that we have a wider UK group as well. And I think these were issues that I think would be worth, I wanted to put on the record regardless of whether the committee supports or doesn't. And I think these are important issues that need to be raised. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Thank you. Does anyone, Deputy Convener? Ben.
Thank you, Convener, and I note colleagues' contributions with interest and do think that this is an area where, as a committee, we will want to keep an eye on developments. However, I was comforted to a large extent and to the point where I will wish to give my consent to the SI by the Cabinet Secretary's response, and I particularly note on the second page that it is stated that it is important to note that the proposals in the UKSI will bring the UK POPs regulation into closer alignment with the EU regulation than is currently the case. So this SI, as set before the UK Parliament and that we are being asked to consent to, will be a step forward in this area, and I also was comforted by the fact that the Cabinet Secretary sets out that Scottish Government, both at ministerial and official level, as you would expect, will continue engagement with counterparts at DEFRA and continue to monitor these matters. So, all things considered, I think I'm content to show consent for this at this point.
Bob, did you want to say something?
Very briefly, I think Mr Ruskell makes some reasonable points. It's whether on balance it's correct to support the statute before us or piece of support the legislation before us or not. I'm minded to look at the Cabinet Secretary's reply to the committee on the 21st of May, which says the SI also revises and adds new conditions to substances and access for Annexes 4 and 5 of the UK POP regulation, which relates to the disposal of waste containing POPs. These proposed changes go beyond the requirements of the Convention and are designed to give certainty to operators and industry on their responsibilities when dealing with POPs waste. So, I mean, within that, we've got it goes beyond what the requirements are and it gives certainty for operators and business, which I think is important. But also in Annex 5, under the EU alignment section, I notice it says, therefore, whilst there is temporary EU misalignment is expected, the EU POP regulation will also soon be amended in accordance with the Stockholm Convention. So it's a temporary misalignment. So not seeking to block this and allowing this to go ahead, I think we should be asking for further information in due course in relation to how this will be monitored by the Scottish Government and that realignment will be secured and achieved going forward. But I don't dismiss or make light of Mr Ruskell's comments, but my position would be to support this as it stands.
Okay, Mark.
Very briefly, to come back on that, there are elements of this statutory instrument which do enable alignment with the EU. So I think Mr. Doris is right to highlight that. However, there are other aspects, particularly when it comes to the regulations and phasing out of certain POPs that are within the regulation, where there is active divergence. So I don't think Mr. Doris is right to say that, you know, this is a temporary measure which will eventually... both the UK approach and Scotland's approach will eventually align with the EU. Yes, it's about adopting regulation of those chemicals that are highlighted under the Stockholm Convention, and there will be continuing alignment on that matter. But in terms of the pace of change, in terms of ruling out and removing these toxic chemicals from our waste streams and from our environment, there is now active divergence. And I think from my perspective, that's the reason why I'm opposing this SI, not for the other elements which Mr. Doris has already mentioned, which are welcome.
So I'm going to let Bob come in, and then Douglas, you want to come in, but I'm letting you back in because you're going to just...
No, just very briefly, because I think that's actually really helpful, Mr. Ruskell, because I'm suggesting that we do support this, but I think the committee should have an ongoing role to, in due course to scrutinise what the impact of this will be, and I think that's important. So whilst myself and Mr. Ruskell may disagree whether to support this today, I think there's a common cause here across the entire committee that this is not a one-off act on behalf of the committee, but there should be ongoing scrutiny, convener.
Thanks, Bob. Very helpful. Douglas?
No, I was just going to add, convener, and Bob just mentioned it there. I think as a committee, we all agree we'll have to remove these toxic chemicals. I presume there's no doubt about that. It's maybe just... what we're seeing here is a practical approach on how we do that, and this is maybe where there'll be a slight disagreement on how we get there on the path there. I was going to mention the response from COSLA as well. They're highlighting financial pressures on councils resulting from new regulations, and I think that's something we've got to be very mindful of, and I think that's why it's right that we take that practical approach. And that's why I'm happy enough to agree the SI as it's put before us today.
Okay, that's helpful. I think because Mark's indicated that he's not prepared to agree it, I think what we should do is go through the process now of seeing what the committee wants to do and ask the committee to vote on it. Then when we've decided on that, we can then decide on what the next step is. Now, it is, I'm told this is done strictly in alphabetical order. So, Sarah Boyer, are you in a position to move to the substantive question that we're content or not content? So I'm going to ask you to say content or not content with the SI. Sarah.
Well, I can actually see some arguments on either side, and today I want to abstain because I want to go into this in a bit more depth. Okay. Thank you.
Bob.
On the basis this committee will have ongoing scrutiny, I'm content, convener.
Thank you. Jackie.
I'm content, convener.
Thank you. Douglas.
Content, convener.
Thank you. Ben.
Content.
Thank you. And I would say I'm content, and Mark.
Not content.
Not content, thank you. Right, so. We're in the situation that we've got, unless I've got that wrong, we've got five contents, we've got one abstention and one not content. So as a majority, the committee is content. But I would suggest that we write and indicate to the Cabinet Secretary our views and our concerns with this, and say that as a result of the conversation today, We think there would be merit in the Cabinet Secretary considering limits on POPs, and to review it and to keep the committee up to date, and that possibly, and this may be only mentioned once, but I wondered whether we'd support a short-life industry working group to look at this issue so it can further inform our opinion. That might be a useful way to allow us further scrutiny. Would we be happy with that? Okay. So on the basis that we are happy with that, are you happy for me, once the letter's been drafted by the clerks, to sign that off and get it away? Because we are quite up against the wall for timescales on that. So are you all content with me signing the letter off? Yeah, thank you. Right, the next item on the agenda is consideration of a Type 1 consent notification relating to a UK proposed statutory instrument, the Invasive Alien Species Delisting Regulation 2024. On the 29th of May, the Minister for Climate Action notified the committee of the proposed UKSI. As with the last item, the UK government is seeking the Scottish Government's consent to legislate in an area of devolved competence. Again, the committee's role is to decide whether it agrees with the Scottish Government's proposal to consent to the UK Government making these regulations within the devolved competence and the manner that the UK Government has indicated to the Scottish Government. If members are content for consent to be given, the committee will write to the Scottish Government accordingly. In writing to the Scottish Government, we have the option to pose a question or ask to be kept up to date on relevant developments. If the committee is not content with the proposal, we can make some of the recommendations which I can go through. But now, just before we do that, I'm going to ask committee members if anyone has any views on this. Mark.
Thank you again, convener. I am content to support this because I don't see this is an issue of policy divergence with the EU. It's more of a technical issue about how these lists of invasive species are drawn up and whether they're fully inclusive on a European basis or whether they're drawn more tightly as to the likely spread of these species within the UK. I mean, I do note that on this list of species that are to be effectively excluded from the list, there is, for example, some aquatic species such as water hyacinth, which are highly invasive, but on the basis that they can't survive in winters in this country, you know, the scientists have made a judgment that there's no point in including them on the list. And I also note that, you know, there's been quite a lot of lobbying, I think, from the aquatic ornamental trade bodies who really want to see this plant, you know, sold again within the UK. I mean, my only kind of point on this, and perhaps this could be reflected in a letter to the Cabinet Secretary, is that, you know, we're obviously in an age of climate change. So what might be a mild winter now might not be it might be very different in 10 or 15 years' time as the climate gets warmer. So these kind of invasive species may be able to get a foothold in this country as the climate changes. So I'm interested in what that kind of review process looks like whenever you draw up a list about whether these species can or cannot thrive in this country. I suppose the other aspect which it would be useful to get feedback from the Scottish Government on is about trade. So as I understand it, you know, this new regulation effectively won't apply in Northern Ireland because of the Windsor framework. It also won't apply in the Republic of Ireland, which remains a member of the EU. So it perhaps just does raise in my mind a question about, you know, if these sort of ornamental species are actually being sold within the UK, what the implications there are for exports, say, from Cairn Ryan through to through Scotland, through to Ireland, Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland. So it's just a query there as to, you know, how these species are actually being regulated in terms of their trade and the kind of checks that exist, given that, you know, we don't have a phytosanitary agreement with the EU.
Thanks very much, Mark. Sarah.
Thanks very much, convener. I also wanted to ask about what is the monitoring that will take place. I'm not against this SI, but I would like to know what the monitoring will be, because I think 4 of these 10 species were previously sold commercially in the UK. So there's an issue about what will happen once businesses are allowed to sell them again, who's going to be doing the monitoring, where will they be coming from? And I just think it's a point Mark made that our climate is changing, so we need to make sure that we keep an eye on this going forward, and I hope that would be a bit of feedback that we could put to the Minister. Thank you.
Thank you. If there's no other members wish to say anything, I'd like to make a couple of observations. One is that when I got the bundle of committee papers for this week, the 206 pages of them, I look forward to reading this UKSI notification and find out instantly what it all meant. It took quite a lot of reading to get through it. I don't think the briefing was helpful or concise from the government. I then looked at each of the species, some of which I'd never heard of before. Small Asian mongoose, I'm sure they can't survive here. A coati, which is another form of mongoose. And white top weed, which I think sometimes is confused with hoary cress in this country. And the water hyacinth that's already been mentioned. I think my concern with all of this is the very fact that things are changing quickly climate-wise, and we are seeing species of invasive, non-native species that come into this country and then are never meant to thrive, and they do thrive. And I guess the example I see from home is ranunculus weed was never an issue on the Spey because it was always too cold and too fast-flowing. But things have changed, temperatures have warmed, and ranunculus weed now is a major problem on the Spey, which I declare an interest that I have a fishery in, but it doesn't affect the fishery, but it absolutely smothers out freshwater mussels, which are an endangered species. So I think we need to be really careful on what we're doing, and therefore I would support the committee's recommendation that if we were going to approve this SI, which I'm minded personally to do, is that we ask the government to keep this under review and to see the effects of these things are doing. And also, when they're writing, if there are future things that are going to come off the list, they make it somewhat clearer what they're doing. I mean, I think there is mention in the paper that DEFRA were asked for a comment, and that's still to be forthcoming. So we're making this decision slightly in the dark. So I think that would be my comments. If there are no other comments from the committee, I want to move to a substantive question. Is the committee content that the provisions set out in the notification should be made to the in the proposed UK statutory instrument? I notice nodding of heads. I take that as agreement. Are we happy also when writing this letter to say to them that we would like reviews carried out and a simplified process should we be asked this to look at this again so we understand what the species are and what reviews have been carried out to make it acceptable to delist them from the invasive non-native species legislation? Yes, Sarah.
I strongly agree with that, convener, because I think for the vast majority of us, this is right under the radar, yeah. And it's really important that somebody is actually effectively monitoring this going forward. Thank you.
So, fine, if we're agreed, can I ask one final question on that? Is the committee happy for me to sign off the letter on behalf of the committee when it's prepared by the clerks? Douglas.
I was just thinking, convener, is it also worth writing to DEFRA again, stating that... you know, we asked for an impact assessment, whether that's been carried out, but we haven't received it yet. And really just to say that we would still like to see it and can they respond to us in future?
Absolutely. We can ask the government for that in relation to these individual items, and we could ask them in future to make sure that's available. So if we're agreed on that as a committee, we're now going to move into private session.